Good morning, and welcome to Tusculum Church Online. We're only a couple of weeks away from being able to see each other in person, so that is something to look forward to. We will be releasing, actually, did we already release details in the newsletter?
Yes.
We did, didn't we?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, you can read all about that in the e-news. And I don't have any other announcements to make this morning. So we will go right to the call to worship, which comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 2 through 4, and then 20 through 22. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is, in Gedi." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa. As they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful." After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever." As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. For our children's message this morning, we are not going to have a video. And to be honest, I don't know how to summarize everything that I think needs to be said and everything that I want to say, but I'm going to do the best that I can. All of you, no matter how young or how old you are, have been given different abilities, different strengths, different privileges. There are things that you can do that other people can't. There are things that you can do that other people cannot do as well. You have been given abilities to do many things. As you look around, you probably notice other people that can do things better than you. They have been given different strengths and different abilities to do things in their lives. I want to make sure that you know and understand that whatever strengths and abilities you have been given, whatever kind of power you have been given, should be used to build people up instead of tearing people down. A lot of people take their power and their strength and their abilities and use it for the wrong reasons. You have been given a voice, and you have been given all kinds of abilities to stand up and to speak. There are people that will listen to you that other people may not. So I would encourage you to use your voice, use your strength to correct the wrong things in the world. Jesus set the perfect example for us in every way. Jesus used his voice to speak up for the people that nobody would pay attention to. Jesus would defend those that nobody else would defend. Jesus would use his abilities to help fix the things that people thought separated them from other people. I hope that as you learn and grow and as your strength develops, as your abilities develop, that you will look at the example of Jesus and follow that example. You can make this world a better place. Amen.
dwells among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Among us, let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise.
the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Everything.
Good morning and welcome to Tusculum Cumberland Presbyterian Church. It is the 7th of June, which means in my family, it is an anniversary, and it's not a great anniversary. It's the anniversary of my wife Jill and my daughter Selah's car accident in 2008. It happened on June 7th, 2008, and I am blessed and thankful to the Lord to have them with me today, and that they are a blessing to this church and to our ministry, and so giving him praise for that. Would you join me? We're going to have our prayer of the people. And I would like for you to, this is responsive, so I would like for, I will read the first part if you'll join me for the second part. Father, we thank you for life. We thank you for this day because it is all that we've been promised. Please forgive us of our sins and make us useful for you today. Fill us with your Holy Spirit and mold us into the image of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for loving us in spite of ourselves. Fill us and produce all your fruit of the Spirit through us, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Let us speak the words of life today. Let our actions be a testimony to our faith in you. Amen. So we're going to read scripture today, and it is from Matthew chapter 12, and it's verses 34 through 37. And it says, "You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned." Would you join me in prayer one more time? Dear Lord, we are thankful today to you that we have a church. We have a church family, that we are the body of Christ, that we have hope and encouragement from our friends and family, that we have the Bible, that we have the gospel truth given to us. We ask, Lord, that and we just thank you for the tithes and offerings that we are able to give, and we ask that you would bless those, that you would use them, and that you'd get them to the people who need them, Lord. I know there are ministries that this church supports, and I pray, Lord, that we are able to fully fund those things and to send out the light into this community and into this state and world, Lord. We ask that you would bless the words that are getting ready to be spoken, that you'd open the Bible to us and explain it to us today, that your Holy Spirit would inspire us and grow us so that we can change the world that we live in. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to be talking about, the title of the sermon today, I believe, is something to the effect of that my tongue punches harder than Mike Tyson. And the reason for that is because we're going to, you know, the tough thing about preaching a continuation sermon from the week before is that many of you may not have seen the one from last week. And so I'm having to build on that for this week. And we talked last week about that the summer is kind of a time for training. It's like a time for boot camp. And that when I was a kid, when school got out, there was such elation, and we started training for baseball, football, basketball, Boy Scouts, band, whatever it might be. We did those camps in the summertime to learn and grow and become better at our skills. And so today, you know, last week I gave you some action steps. I gave you some skills that we need to work on that are part of our tool chest, part of those things being like working on our prayer life and on reading the Bible and understanding Scripture, working together, obedience, practice, those kind of things. So today we're going to talk about one thing. We're only going to focus in on one, and that is taming our tongue. And you know, if we were talking about training, how fit are you, or how well are you trained in certain areas? You know, we just had riots going on in certain parts of the country, and if someone was chasing you, how far could you run to get away from them? If you had to run the 100-yard dash to safety, could you make it? I think after about 15 yards, I'd be going, okay, I give up. Okay, I'm not running any further than this, especially when it's 93 degrees outside like it is today. What about my friend Randy and I, we would go out and we would shoot. We had a friend that had a huge farm, and we would go out there and shoot guns, whether it was handguns or rifles or shotguns, and we just have fun doing that, whether it was skeet. And Randy would set up these targets out there, and I don't own any guns, but I like to shoot guns and don't have much training in it. And he said, "Don't worry, I'm good at this. I can teach you how to do this." And he set up this target that was a post, and it had another post that went this way, and he had cans that were attached via screws on top of this, and it was probably this long and had probably, I don't know, 15 or 20 cans on the top of it. And we were supposed to aim at it, and you know, I'm taking the handgun and I'm holding it there and I'm looking like this and I'm shooting, and I shot again real slow, and he goes, no. He goes, "Just go ahead and point it and pull the trigger several times and try to shoot those cans." And I did, and I had fun. I liked the noise and all that, and I had fun shooting it. And then we went and looked at the target, and none of the cans were hit. Not one nip, not one little place on them. And Randy looked over at me, and he goes, "Man, you're a good shot." And I said, "What? I'm a good shot?" And he said, "Yeah," he goes, "every one of your bullets went right in between those little spaces between the cans. You hit none of them." And I went, you really are a good friend, Randy. Thank you so much for the positive encouragement, because that's all it was. I'm a terrible shot. But think about, that's training. That's one of the things, you know, learning how to do stuff. Just like we mentioned last week about playing the guitar or learning a foreign language or learning to play golf or something like that, that it takes these tools in our toolbox that we have to develop them. Just like if Brian was sitting down at the piano with me to teach me how to play the piano, I have to learn certain things. Reading music, I have to learn to keep a beat, all of those. So today we're talking about the process. You know, Sela saw just a few weeks back, she saw a chrysalis hanging, and we talked about caterpillar to chrysalis to beautiful butterfly, and that's what our goal is. Our goal is to take hold of Jesus' message and his word and have it transform us from lowly caterpillar into beautiful butterfly that is productive and out in the world producing fruit for him. And so here we are, we're trying to get in this metamorphosis, this transformation to go on in our lives. And so we're trying to figure out, okay, what am I going to do about these words? Let's look at last week's scripture, which is from David and Goliath in 1 Samuel 17. And let's pick up in verse 38. And it says, and this is when David has come to King Saul, and he's wanting to go out and to fight Goliath at this point, and Saul's trying to help him. And the king says, "Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around because he was not used to them. 'I cannot go in these,' he said to Saul, 'because I'm not used to them.' So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream." And everybody here has been through a Sunday school class or a vacation Bible school lesson or youth group meeting, children's group that maybe Brittany or somebody else was teaching. And he's talked about those 5 smooth stones. The fact that Goliath had 4 brothers, that there were 5 rulers of the Philistine kingdom, and they each ruled a city. And so he picked up 5, because if he killed the first brother, he figured he might have to do the other 4 as well. And so those 5 smooth stones into his bag, put them in his pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with his sling in his hand approached the Philistine. Verse 41, "Meanwhile, the Philistine with his shield bearer in front of him kept coming closer to David. He looked David over and saw that he was little more than a boy, glowing with health and handsome, and he despised him." Now let's remember, we're talking about words today, the taming of our tongue. And listen to Goliath's words. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come at me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals." David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel." Remember that right there, because the rules of war, what if you were a soldier, if you had been trained by the world, then you would know sword, spear, javelin, you know, all of those things, right? But if you have God on your side, there are different weapons available to us, and we don't have to use those weapons. And that's something that we need to learn, because a lot of us go to work and we learn how to make people do what we want them to do. We manipulate them, we use different tactics and tools, different words, and then we take those and we bring those home and we use those same tactics and words. We bring them to church, we use those same tactics and words, and they're inappropriate. They're not what needs to happen in the body of Christ or in our families. And that's why we struggle as in our marriages and as parents and in our churches. And so we need to relearn what we're doing. And Goliath said, I've got all the stuff ready for war. And David said, I don't need any of that stuff. He says, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Did you hear that last part? Because that's the thing that we need to have on a pillow when we wake up in the morning and we look at it. The battle is the Lord's, not mine. I don't have to think up something clever to say, or have to come up, you know, some cut down or some comeback to be able to go out into the world and deal with people at work and in my family and wherever else. I just have to allow God to fight that battle for me. And in the story, you know that David takes the sling and the stone, and it says he runs at Goliath. He's eager there, does this giant, you know, in baseball we call it a crow hop, and he lets go of it. And remember last week we talked about on Goliath, there's very few spots that you could hit him and hurt him, because he's wearing all this armor. He's huge, 9 feet 9 inches, but you really can't hurt him too much. And yet, who guides the stone? Well, we'd say David is the one with the sling and the stone, and yes, he has practiced, and yes, he's done his part, and he slings that stone, and God, taking the wind and everything else into consideration, whatever it might be, the weight of that stone, how fast David slung it, he made it hit Goliath right in the forehead in such a place that he just fell down. That is the God that we serve, and battles against giants in our lives and defeats them for us. Okay, so today, let's look at some scriptures about how we're supposed to get things done in our lives. Remember, golly, you know, words are so important. Yeah, I can remember a couple of occasions, and my daughter is not at fault. It's just two different times in my life when she was real little. She came and I was watching TV, and she jumped up in my lap and snuggled back into my belly, and she goes, Dad, you're fat like Santa Claus. And I went, I think she means something good about it. There's a huge smile on her face, and she's like, you know, doing this number and just snuggling with me. And then another time she did the exact same thing, and she looked up at me with these beautiful eyes, and she said, Dad, you got a lot of hair in your nose. And I'm like, the power of words. And we would just go, little kids say the darndest things, right? But the power of words, because our friends and family and people, strangers and acquaintances, they say mean things to us all the time. And what are we supposed to do about it? That's what we're trying to get to today. So let's flip to James chapter 3, back in the back, because that is kind of the heart of the New Testament in terms of us finding exactly what we're supposed to do about when somebody says these things to us. James, written by Jesus's brother, most people believe that to be the case, and the whole chapter is entitled Taming the Tongue. And it says in verse 1 of chapter 3, not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. And it's kind of getting at the heart of our words and the things that we say. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who's never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder, wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire. There's the first word that the Bible describes our tongue as a fire. A world of evil. a fire, a world of evil, among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Pointing out the fact to us that we have to gain control. We have to allow God to gain control of our tongues so that when we go out in the world that we're used by Him, not by Satan. Remember, John 10:10, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Our presence in the world is supposed to be more like the fruit of the Spirit that we read in that prayer. And if you're interested, that shows the fruit of the devil in 5:19 of Galatians. So you can see it kind of mirrors those two right beside them so that we can look at them side by side. 5:19 and 5:22, you can look at those and compare those for a devotional this week if you want to, and kind of see what part, which side you're working for at this particular point in your life. A couple of scriptures that I also want to make sure that we see, James chapter 1, I've quoted many times in sermons here over the last 5 months, which is, be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, right? That's for us as something to put in our toolbox. We're supposed to listen more than we speak. And there's a reason for that, because for us, when we start doing action steps and we start trying to figure out how can I improve my communication and my listening, and how can I fix all the miscommunication in my life that's causing so much trouble, how can I fix my words, then we start looking at these kinds of things about having to listen more than we speak. You know, number one, the thing that happens to us over time that we have to realize, it's something that we have to take into account, is that we listen with filters. And they're filters not necessarily that God gave us, they're filters of how we were raised. It's filters of, you know, whether it's teachers, coaches, parents, friends, brothers and sisters, boyfriends and girlfriends, the preacher we had, our neighborhood that we grew up in. It trains us to hear things in a certain way. For me, a lot of times, you know, coaches when I was growing up, they were not positive people. Nowadays, a lot of coaches are very positive people, build you up, help you to achieve what you can achieve. When I was younger, I walked on at the University of Tennessee to play baseball, and in the first 6 weeks I was there, I believe the assistant coach at UT's baseball team called me the F word about 3,000 times. Over and over and over, hammering me, telling me how terrible I was at baseball. And I just sat there and I went, you know, this is not a very fun game to me anymore. I think I'll quit. And I left. Took that from me because I allowed him to use those words to tear me down. Now, what he was doing was trying to be a Marine and tear me down to build me back up. I never got to the second half of that. I just finally said, you know, I do stink as bad as you say. I'm quitting at this point. So for us, we hear through filters, and sometimes we start talking to our spouse or talking to our kids, and we're hearing things in a certain way, and those filters kick in our lives. When the school that I attended when I was in middle school and high school was very money oriented. Everything that you did was equated to, if you do this and you do it well, you'll get lots of money. You'll be rich. You'll have this big house. You'll have this big car, these boats. And so when people speak to me, sometimes I start hearing them in that prosperity gospel kind of language. You know, I start hearing, you know, God's blessing means, oh yeah, we're going to have big, big money bags laying around us. No, that's not true. That's not what Scripture says to us. It says we'll be blessed, and monetarily might be one of those things for us, especially if we're good at using that money to meet the needs of those around us, but it doesn't necessarily mean we're going to be wealthy. All right, so let's look at the second one that's here. The first one was hearing through those filters and trying, you know, we have to be able to understand that that's going on, and then use some of the details that are in Philippians chapter 4, where it says, in your life every single day, think about the things that are good, the things that are right, the things that are beautiful. Meditate on those things. I'm summarizing, but that's what it's pointing out. And for many of us, that's a metamorphosis. That's a transformation in us. We have to be able to get to that point where we've changed the filter of how we see and hear things that come across us in this world. Okay, the second one is how we listen, and how we listen affects miscommunication, and we can fix it. Gary Smalley, and I don't know if he came up with this or he stole the idea from somebody else, just like I'm stealing it from Gary, but there is in marriage counseling a thing called the speaker-listener technique, and if you'll put this in practice with your boss, with your spouse, with your kids, whoever it might be, man alive, it will make life so much easier for you. Now, you may be saying, Chris, don't give me some technique, okay? Come on, that sounds very difficult. Not at all. Not at all. When you're having a conversation with somebody, you say, you go first. You go ahead and say whatever it is you need to say. Whether there's conflict or not, whether they're teaching you something, whatever it is, let them speak. When they get done speaking, you don't interrupt. When they get done speaking, then you say, this is what I heard you say, and you repeat it back to them. And most of the time when you repeat it back, they go, no, that is not what I said. Because we hear differently, especially men versus women. Goodness gracious, we struggle sometimes to understand what our wives are saying and what our husbands are saying. And so this speaker-listener technique lets you hone it down to get to where you're both on the same page. Got to be able to use that. And again, if we're talking about the idea of we've got two ears and one mouth, listening twice as often as we speak, the speaker-listener technique works really well to help us get rid of miscommunication. And man, that's what we fight over more than anything in our... We hear coaches say things about our kids, and we only hear part of it, and we get mad, and we go over, and I say, I'm going to give you a piece of my mind, coach. I heard you say this. And they go, whoa, I didn't say that. You only heard part of it. I said this in addition. So it helps us to keep from getting in spots like that. The third one that's out there is we've got to learn to bite our tongue. Man alive. For us, this is, you know, it's easier to say that than to do it, especially if we're on that frustration scale that I've talked about a couple of times, where we're getting angrier and angrier and angrier as we get more and more frustrated. But my friend, goodness gracious, we were in church, and we're talking about biting our tongues. We're in church, and I'm using this as an example. When I was a kid growing up, I was sitting in a big room full at a worship service of people, probably 300 or 400 folks sitting there, and a lady got up, and she was on about the second row, and she went to the bathroom during the middle of the worship service. She goes out, she comes back in, and as she comes back into the worship service, her dress is tucked into her pantyhose in the back, and all you can see is her pantyhose and her behind as she walks down the middle aisle, coming all the way back to the second row to have a seat. Now, she walked by about 30 rows of people on both sides, walked right down the center aisle, and no one stopped her to say, let me help you here. Let me help you keep from being more embarrassed than you already are. Let me show you what's going on here. Let me help you fix your dress. No one. In fact, what was going on is most everybody was going, oh my God, look at this. Oh my God, you got to see this. Amen. And everybody is, there's these snickers and laughter. Nobody said anything. Now, after the service was over, what were 90% of the people sitting there talking about after the service was over? Oh my goodness. Did you see Jill Caldwell's dress? It was tucked into her pantyhose. Can you believe that she did that? This is the best church service I've ever been to in my life. I've never laughed so hard than when, right? And the Bible says to us, you know, we're not supposed to be gossiping, and it makes it real clear to us, and it lays it out for us in Proverbs, hey, that's not something we're supposed to be about. And so we've got to be able to get to where we bite our tongues and that we start thinking about somebody else, and what if that had been us that was happening to? Wouldn't you want somebody to stop that and put an end to it and help you in that particular situation, just like toilet paper on your shoe or whatever it might be, broccoli caught between your teeth? You'd rather have somebody tell you that your fly is open as opposed to going and putting it out on Instagram or Snapchat or putting it on YouTube or wherever. So for us, we're going to take hold of those situations, and we're going to listen to 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. For though we live, the 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And here it comes. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. So for us, we have to learn, and we're training ourselves to grab hold of those things. We're asking God to help us to think about what we're going to say before it actually comes out of our mouths. We want to hold that in as long as possible in those situations where we go, I'm going to zing you so bad. You know what I'm saying? My kids, They used to do, they didn't know that this is what it was called, but they used to do the dozens when they were kids. I mean, I have four children and my three boys that are like 20 months apart of each other. And so they would start saying mean things like, your mama's so short that she can hang glide on a Dorito, stuff like that. And they would go back and forth with this. And finally, one day they're doing this, and one of my sons says, your mama's so fat that when she steps on the scale, it says to be continued. Or it says one at a time, something like that. And so when he said it, everybody laughed, all the kids laughed, and I went, you know, you're talking about your mama, right there, Jill, that's who you're talking about. And they went, that wasn't what we were doing. We weren't talking about mama. We would never say mama, you know, and all this kind of stuff. But we think about, in those situations where someone's going at us and then coming right back, that we need to take every thought captive before we say it, because it's escalating the situation. It doesn't help us sometimes to open our mouths and say a response, because it just ratchets up the tension and the stress and the frustration, and then they say something else, and then we've got to say, you see what I'm saying? We're trying to find peace in our lives. We're trying to bring joy and love into our lives. We're trying to find ways that we can accomplish things and get things fixed in our lives so that they're not things that keep us lying awake at night. The next one that's on the list, now let me say this. I have a good friend named Susan, and Susan said, you know, when you really want to zing somebody, when you really want to say something, you really got that thing that you just really want to say, you shouldn't say it. You know that's the one you never say. She said, but when you're sitting there and they're saying something and you go, man, I don't want to say anything. I just want to hide. I just want to leave. I just want to crawl under a rock. I don't want to say anything. She said, that's when you know you're supposed to speak up. So use that as a scale a little bit to help you in those situations. Number four, in terms of speaking, it's more like the swim coach who is saying to us, you know, they throw us in the water, or they get us out in the water, and we start kind of drowning when we're taking swimming lessons. You know, the water's getting up in our mouth, and we're kind of doing flailing around and all this, and we're like really scared and upset. And they say, they take hold of you, pull you into the water where you can stand up, and then they say, don't do that, do this instead. Well, that's what God says to us so many times in Scripture, is he says, okay, you're using your words for lying, hurting people, boasting, cursing, discouraging people, gossiping, mocking, threatening, and laughing at people. Stop doing that. Stop using what the world uses it for and do this instead. And the words are sing. Use your mouth to sing. Use your words to sing and praise and give thanks, to testify about who God is, to encourage, to teach, preach, kiss somebody. I mean, golly, and all the middle schoolers are all like, kissing somebody? Oh my goodness, in terms of what we use our mouths for, wailing or crying. Use it for things that are for laughter, in the sense of laughing with somebody, not at what they're doing. And so for us, stop doing this and start doing this instead. And then you see improvement. And I've got a scripture that I want to read from Ephesians, and it's one that I read constantly to in sermons and stuff, because it's one of the things that we need to hear over and over. It's Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Because if it hurts those who listen, then they tend to retaliate against us. And so we need to be, hey, what are my words going to be? They're going to be encouraging words. They're going to be, I'm going to stop doing this as the world taught me to do, and I'm going to start doing this that God's teaching me to do in his word. The last one that's there is that we have to realize that we need to let God take care of it. Two different places, at least, in the Bible. You have Old Testament and New Testament. If the Bible says it one time, I tend to pay attention. If it says it twice, man, I really take it to heart and I write it down. But in Leviticus 19, 18, and in Romans 12, 19 through 21, God makes it straight and clear for us to understand what he's talking about, how we're supposed to live our lives. Romans 12, 19 through 21. And I think I want to start in 17. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what's right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. For us, we are called to, God says, hey, I can take care of this, like David and Goliath. I can take care of this, and you won't ever have to have a shield, a sword, or a javelin. You don't have to do that. I'll guide that stone. But for you, let me take care of it. Let me be the one who ends this issue with your enemy, with this person that you've got conflict with at work, or your spouse, or your kid, or whatever it might be. And we give it to him, and we put it in his hands, and we leave room for him. Me, I'm notorious for, we'll get to a stopping place in a discussion that we're having, and then I'll walk around the house for the next hour saying, as I walk by different rooms, going, you know, I'm right, what I said about that thing over there that we were talking about earlier. You know what it said, and right, and I'm still pecking. I'm still throwing these little jabs here and there instead of leaving room for God to take care of it. In the movie The End of the Spear, it is a story of Jimmy Elliot, Nate Saint, Pete Fleming, Ed McCulley, and Roger Yudarian, who were all missionaries in 1956 to the Aka Indians in Ecuador. They flew a plane and they landed after they had been trying to communicate with these Indians for a period of time to try to evangelize and try to share the message of Jesus with them. And over a period of time, they decided that it was safe enough for them to land and meet these Indians face to face. And the Indians killed all five of them, left their bodies in the water right there in the river where they had landed beside. And it was on Life magazine's cover in the 50s, and I think 2,000 missionaries or something like that signed up to go in places around the world that day when that issue came out. But the story is Nate Saint had a sister named Rachel, and he wouldn't let her be a part of that, but Rachel wanted to be a missionary as well in Ecuador, and she was trying to learn the language of the Aka Indians, and she couldn't find anybody that was willing or able to be able to share it with her, and she finally heard of one person, and so she traveled across country to a coffee farm, and she went to meet this girl, and her name was Dayuma. And Dayuma had been an Aka Indian, was an Aka Indian, but she was working on the coffee plantation, and she agreed to be able to teach Rachel how to speak the language. Well, as she's learning the language and spending time with Dayuma, they build a relationship, a friendship, and finally, when Rachel's brother and all the other four missionaries are killed, Dayuma runs off into the rainforest, into the jungle, and she disappears. And over a period of time, through prayer and communication that goes on, Rachel goes to the edge of the rainforest and meets Dayuma, who comes out with some of the folks from her tribe. And Rachel said, "Why did you run off?" And she said, "Well, it was my family, relatives of mine, who killed your brother and his friends that were there by that river that day. And I was afraid that you were then going to kill me to get revenge in this situation." And Rachel said, "No, that's not the way my God works. You and I have a friendship, and you didn't do anything to kill my brothers. And in fact, what we need to do is work together to reach your family and to tell them about the forgiveness of God so they don't end up in hell." And working together, Dayuma's family came to know the Lord and experience the forgiveness that comes from Jesus. And for us, we would say, "Goodness gracious, Chris, you said that they killed missionaries." Yeah. And yet God was big enough in their confession and repentance to forgive them for that. And they turned to him and said that they were sorry for doing it. They did it in ignorance out of their evil, sinful ways. And for us, you know, we see Rachel using her words instead of taking revenge, instead of cutting down, instead of yelling and screaming and being so upset that Dayuma's family had something to do with it, she turned it for good. She overcame evil with good. And that's what God is calling us to today. So this is another tool that needs to go in our toolbox, another piece of training that we need to work on this summer, taming our tongue. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, I thank you so much for today and the opportunity to grow, for opportunity to be trained by you, and that we are the body of Christ and we're here to sharpen one another as iron sharpens iron, that we are here to help one another and encourage one another and to pray for one another. And I pray, Lord, that for each of us that we could take hold of these building blocks and we could put them into practice in our lives. Help us, Lord, to know you better and to experience your blessings more and more. Help this church to fill every seat in it, not only in their worship services, but in their Bible studies and fellowship dinners and service projects and mission trips and camps and retreats and all those wonderful things where we reach out into our communities, Lord. Bless this church and bless our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Today is Communion Sunday. It's the first Sunday of the month, and we're going to be taking communion together. And I always read from Matthew chapter 26, and it's verse 26 as well. And it says, "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, 'Take and eat, this is my body.' Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" So today we're doing virtual communion because we're not together yet. We're excited about June 21st and being back together again. But hopefully you have had the time to be able to and recognize that first Sunday of the month is when we do communion, and you have taken some bread or crackers at your house and some juice, and that you have those available to you right now. It said Jesus took bread, and this is bread, and he gave thanks. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we ask your blessing on this element, at these crackers, as they represent your body, the unleavened bread of Passover, that it's your body that was broken for us. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Said in the same way, he took the cup and he gave thanks. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, we thank you for this bread and this juice. We thank you for the juice because it represents your body. And it represents your blood that was shed, whether it was the crown of thorns or the spear in your side, or when they nailed you hands and feet to the cross, whether it was when they beat you and tortured you. It represents the forgiveness from the Old Testament, the forgiveness of sins. You sacrificed yourself for us, and we're thankful for it today. Please bless this element in Jesus' name. Amen. And blood of Christ shed for you, will you partake?
hurting and broken within. Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling you. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling.
In Romans chapter 10, you know, that we just sang, come to the altar, verses 9 and 10, Romans 10, 9 and 10. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. You know, the people asked Peter when he preached in the book of Acts, what are we supposed to do? We understand that it's our sin. What are we supposed to do? And he said, repent and be baptized, every single one of you, and you will be saved. And so for us, here we stand today, you know, and maybe we're sitting at home watching this and we're trying to decide, do I want to be a Christian? How do I do that? It's a simple prayer of us. And I always say the ABCs: accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, believe that he died on the cross for your sins, and confess your sins to him and confess that he is Lord. And you will be saved. And so today you have that, and that is the good news. That is a promise that is repeated in Scripture over and over. We receive the benediction from, I believe it's from the book of Acts today, chapter 20, verses 32 through 35. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. God bless you. Have a great week.